fantastic. We have had challenges in this family. But we find that this annual prayer has helped us through our challenges. It has brought us close together. Seeing that we have to sit and stand in front of all of you who expect so much from us, it has helped us to come together, bond with each other, find less fault with each other, and love each other more.
Oyinade Odutola Olurin is a former professor of ophthalmology at the University College Hospital, UCH, Ibadan, and recipient of an Order of the Federal Republic Award in 2005. She spearheaded the plundering of Chief Adeola Odutola's safe on Monday, April 10, 1995, and 3 days later, his kidnap and murder on Thursday, April 13, 1995. She never refuted or responded to Mr. Adedapo Sunday Odutola's November 26, 1997 letter, accusing her of fraud and murder. This video is review of Oyinade Odutola Olurin's response to a letter written by Mr. Ademola Adewumi Odutola on October 30, 1995. Mr. Ademola Adewumi Odutola was Chief Adeola Odutola's second son, the first child of his first wife, Mrs. Juliana Otubanke Odutola ni Onolaja. He was a man of integrity and seasoned businessman who also worked with Chief Adeola Odutola at his factories. He had first-hand knowledge of the intrigues and machinations leading to the death of Chief Adeola Odutola. He passed on Tuesday, June 11, 2013. The letter.
Oyinade Odutola Olurin, 8 Ladoke Akintola Avenue, Bodija, Ibadan, Oyo State. Date, 13 December, 1995. Mr. Ademola A. Odutola, Julie O. Business Enterprises Limited, P.O. Box 3768, Surulere, Lagos. My dear brother, Ademola, I hope all is well with you and your family. Your letter dated 30th October, 1995 did not get to me until today. Although I saw a copy last week, you omitted to let me know the circulation. My first impression was to ignore your letter because it appeared absolutely ridiculous and full of malicious insinuations. But I was advised that in law, however stupid allegations might sound, one must always try to reply to all points. Your letter is so full of false statements that it is difficult to know where to start. But maybe paragraph by paragraph for easy reference is the best thing. Oyinade Olurin's response to Mr. Ademola Odutola's letter dated October 30, 1995 didn't come until December 13, 1995. That's almost 2 months of not providing response to an accusation of a very serious crime, murder. That she did not receive a copy until December 13, 1995, but had seen a copy of mail addressed to her on the week of December 3, 1995 is beyond progress. Also, she wrote, "My first impression was to ignore your letter because it appeared absolutely ridiculous and full of malicious insinuations. But I was advised that in law, however stupid allegations might sound, one must always try to reply all points. It is nothing but arrogance and condescension, and an attempt to prevent others from discovering a crime. Why so? Let's fast forward to Wednesday, November 26, 1997. That was when Mr. Adedapo Sunday Odutola wrote a letter to Oyinade Olurin, which is provided in another video. He went on the offensive, took Oyinade head-on, and won. Challenged the authenticity of the will that was read out to Odutola family at Abeokuta. 2. Accused Oyinade Olurin and a few others of the murder of Chief Adeola Odutola. Furthermore, he challenged Oyinade Olurin to have a lawyer, Chief Afebabalola, file a lawsuit against him in court, a challenge she never entertained. It is anyone's guess why she didn't file a lawsuit for defamation. Mr. Adedapo Odutola passed away on September 20, 2000, and Oyinade Olurin never provided a response to his letter. Silver claimed that she was advised that in law, however stupid allegations might sound, one must always try to reply to all points, is bogus and beyond arrogance. It is obvious that Oyinade Olurin has a credibility problem.
The letter.
First of all, at the first family gathering, no one decided that I should formally inform the family of his, that is Chief Adeola Odutola's, last moments alive. I volunteered the information which I had after he had died. The last time I saw him, that is Chief Adeola Odutola, alive was on Tuesday 11th April with Mrs. Shade Shofola and Papa's doctor. I left before both of them to take some blood samples to Ibadan at the request of the attending doctor. I had planned to see him in any case again on Thursday morning before embarking on the preparations for my son's wedding. And I had alerted Mrs. B.C. Bateye that I was going to see Papa, that is Chief Adeola Odutola, and she wanted to go with me. On Tuesday, April 11, 1995, Oyinade Olurin forcibly took blood samples from a frail but healthy 92-year-old Chief Adeola Odutola, despite his insistence that there was no need to take blood samples from him because he was perfectly well and had no health complaint or problem. His wife, Mrs. Ademola Odutola, Mama Bisoe, who was with him at the time preparing to serve him snacks, small chops, was in shock, horrified, and helpless. The blood sample was meant for one of Oyinade Olurin's usual witchcraft rituals. Mrs. Shade Shofola, a contrived alibi, was not at Onibudo House at the material time. She was one of the individuals who accompanied her to raid and loot his safes on Monday, April 10, 1995.
The letter.
I, however, got a telephone call from Mr. Ignatius, Chief Odutola's personal assistant, early on Thursday morning to tell me that his health situation was very critical. I told the caller that his doctor should be called to see him, and I traveled immediately to Jebode with Mrs. Bateye. Your information about nurses is of course entirely false. The nurses who had been arranged for Papa by the doctor in the Jebode General Hospital had left a week or two before Papa died. I am sure Papa's brother, Alhaji J.A. Odutola, did not tell you that I saw him on the day Papa died. I have since not had any conversation with him on the matter. I certainly would not have gone visiting anybody with a supposedly critically ill man in the vehicle. I am a doctor, not a socialite. If Mama Bisoye told you she assisted Papa with his bath, that's our affair. My information was that the men who looked after Papa found him dead in the morning. Olu Odutola was in the house when we got there, and he told us Papa had died and that he had informed Brother Ladipo. I had myself alerted Brother on Wednesday evening that Papa was very ill. Papa had vomited some of the remains of the food he ate at the night before. The tablets he took were on the outside of his mouth. Both the doctor and I confirmed that he had been dead for a few hours. There are signs which we saw which one could not expect you to understand. The doctor did not have a suitable ambulance, so he arranged for one from the brewery. That Mr. Ignatius, Chief Odutola's personal assistant, called Oyinade Olurin on Thursday morning to notify her that Chief Odutola's health situation was critical could not have been true. That statement is not true but prevarication and concealed more than she revealed. Whose testimony is more compelling? Mrs. Ademola Odutola, Mama Bisoye, Chief Odutola's wife of 40 years, who, one, had 8 children for Chief Odutola, 5 sons and 3 daughters. Two, Odutola family and extended family members knew to be very loyal to Chief Odutola. Three, lived with and cared for Chief Ademola Odutola before and after he suffered stroke in 1981, preparing his meals and seeing to his needs. Four, claimed she provided tender loving care, TLC, to a lucid, frail but healthy 92-year-old Chief Odutola and prepared and served him breakfast on Thursday, April 13, 1995. 5. Was at home in her apartment and didn't see the corpse of Chief Odutola on the inauspicious day, Thursday, April 13, 1995. Oyinade Olurin alleged he was found dead in his room. Then he took his corpse to the University of Ibadan. Department of Anatomy, or of Oyinade Olurin, who, one, when mortified, euthanized, that is, performed assisted suicide to her mother, Grace Ariola Ogulesi, on May 27, 1977, when she was in the throes of witchcraft confessions on admission at University College Hospital, UCH, Ibadan. Two, was exposed in 1981 by Olufemilayo Odutola for practicing Chief Odutola's signature. Three, was in a party of six that at Chief Odutola's objection, plundered his safe on April 10, 1995, carting away with gold jewelry and coins and real estate documents. Four, drove to Ijebuode from Ibadan, claimed she also found Chief Odutola dead at his primary residence, requested for an ambulance but didn't notify his wife Mama Bisoye, who was at home in her apartment, some meters from Chief Odutola's personal residence, or his younger brother Alhaji Jimo Odutola, who lived across from him to give him an opportunity to see the corpse of his only brother. Five, drove the corpse of Chief Adeola Odutola directly to the University of Ibadan Department of Anatomy and not University College UCH Ibadan, where his death and cause of death should have been confirmed and certified. Six, colluded with Mrs. Ashiru, a Union Bank Ijebuode senior staff member, in 1995 to perpetrate fraud on Chief Adeola Odutola's will by presenting a document dated May 1995 that bore Chief Adeola Odutola's signature a month after his death. Seven, in concert with Akela and Oladipo Mabogoje, destroyed Chief Odutola's factories in Kano, Ibadan, and Ijebuode, selling all the vehicles, machines and equipment in his factories. Eight, has been putting up Chief Adeola Odutola's lands for sale. Nine, has been selling properties belonging to the Odutola estate. 10, continues to misappropriate funds in the coffers of Odutola estate. 11, arrogated to her head of Odutola family when much older sons were living, an unthinkable feat in Yoruba culture. Again, Mr. Ignatius was another contrived alibi for Oyinade Olurin. It is quite possible that he was the individual Oyinade Olurin asked to call the jury on that fateful day and requested for an ambulance Oyinade Olurin, Adebisi Bate, and Adeshola Adeyemi used to kidnap Chief Odutola. What Oyinade Olurin revealed was that Mrs. Adebisi Bate was also at the crime scene, and Mr. Ignatius was an accessory in the murder of Chief Adeola Odutola, a person who did not want to be identified, said Mr. Ignatius, who typed most of Chief Odutola's correspondence and his will, told him Ignatius had passed a copy of the will to Oyinade Olurin and that he was handsomely rewarded. Oyinade Olurin has a credibility problem. Details of some of Oyinade Olurin's evil acts are provided on page 249. My pro bono services of Akema Boboje, a former professor of geography's autobiography, A Measure of Grace, the autobiography of Akela Oladipo Maboboje. Surely, Oyinade Olurin has a credibility problem. That Fumilayo Odutola, who lived in Mobalu for Ijebuode, about 2 kilometers from Onibudo House, told Oyinade Olurin that Chief Adeola Odutola had died when she arrived was another statement to conceal their crime. Olufemilayo Odutola was another contrived alibi. Also, that Mr. Oladipo Odutola's first son, who was much older than Oyinade Olurin, was alerted on the evening of Wednesday, April 12, 1995, that Chief Adeola Odutola was very ill, his lunar miles far from the truth. Furthermore, that Papa, Chief Odutola, had vomited some of the remains of the food he ate the night before, and that the tablets he took were on the outside of his mouth is totally untrue. Why? Mrs. Adeola Odutola Mama Bisoye, his wife of 40 years, who provided him tender loving care, TLC, on a daily basis, and who had 8 children for Chief Odutola, claimed that Chief Adeola Odutola was well and healthy on Thursday, April 13, 1995, and that she had helped him with his bath and breakfast. So there is something wrong with Oyinade Olurin's claim that he was very ill on Wednesday, April 12, 1995. Who is better to know the status of Chief Adeola Odutola's health than his wife, Mrs. Ademola Odutola? Surely it cannot be his personal assistant, Ignatius Olufemola Odutola or Oyinade Olurin. Now, stories abound about Olufemola Odutola's propensity to steal. Chief Adeola Odutola had written an unsigned codicil to have Olufemola kicked out of his house and businesses when he dies. But his request was ignored by Oyinade Olurin and Akimabo Buje. Olufemola Odutola, Oyinade Olurin and Akinlawo Ladipo Mabuguje were instrumental in selling all the machines and equipment in Chief Adeola Odutola's factories. Again, Oyinade Olurin has a credibility problem, and so does Olufemola Odutola. Incidentally, Chief Odutola's mind and memory had not declined as of the day, Thursday, April 13, 1995, he was kidnapped and murdered by Oyinade Olurin, Adebisi Bate and Adeshola Dien. He could voice his needs and could still sign checks. He was just frail from old age and the physical side effect of the stroke he sustained in 1981.
The letter.
Of course, Papa was helpless, as you say. He was dead. The dead are usually helpless, so that statement is quite correct. Unfortunately, he could not ask to put a cap on, as you suggested, and he certainly could not sit up. I am not sure what you mean by my prize catch. A dead man, not for eating, or for sale, is hardly a prize catch to any sane person. Papa had always advocated that it be embalmed and not refrigerated, and the best place I know for that was the anatomy department in Ibadan. I did not ask to paint in black. I am sorry if you still have doubts that it was really Papa that died and was buried. He had his ring on his finger and it was buried with him. Oyinade Olurin drove the corpse of Chief Adeola Odutola directly to the University of Ibadan, Department of Anatomy, and not University College Hospital, UCH Ibadan, where his death and cause of death should have been confirmed and certified. That alone should raise eyebrows. Now, Mr. Ademola Odutola's inquiry about Chief Odutola's fingering has merit, because in the photos we have of the hands of the corpse of Chief Odutola, his hands and therefore fingers were at no time visible, not at the Department of Anatomy, University of Ibadan, during the lying in state, or at the church during his funeral. Oyinade Olurin and her conspirators wore gloves on the hands of his corpse to conceal a missing ring. It is quite possible that Oyinade Olurin and her murder conspirators needed it for one of their witchcraft rituals. Just like Olabimpo Shinaike demanded, like it was a prize catch, for the very first towels used by the laboratory technician to clean the corpse of Chief Adeola Odutola at the Department of Anatomy, University of Ibadan, hollering and claiming that they were hers. The person who once quit, Oyinade Olurin is witchcraft, and witchcraft is Oyinade Olurin, could not have been more right.
The letter
left instructions with some of us as to when he was to be buried. I did not know what instructions he had left in his will or in his safe until that was opened in front of everybody. I did ask if he wanted his body brought back to Ijebode on Sunday, but consensus was that he should be left in Ibadan until the day before the burial. As for the keys with which you seem to be so obsessed, the explanation is quite simple. On Monday 10th April, when Mama Inka telephoned to tell me that Papa was very drowsy, she said she was afraid that someone may give him a check to sign by default in his drowsy state, and that I should come and take his checks. I had no intention of doing this, but it would have been irresponsible of me not to heed her warning. I therefore asked Mr. Francis where the checkbooks were, and he said that they were in the cabinet, not the safe. I asked them to lock the cabinet and give me the keys. That on Monday, April 10, 1995, Modupe Odutola Mama Inka, Chief Odutola's last wife, called Oyinade Olurin about 74 kilometers away in Ibadan and notified her that Papa, Chief Adeola Odutola, was very drowsy and was afraid that someone may give him a check to sign by default in his drowsy state. And Mama Inga had asked Oyinade Olurin to come for his checkbooks in Ijebu-Ode is ridiculously untrue. Why so? Modupe Odutola, Mama Inka, was not at Onibudo House on that day. She had cunningly requested visitation trip to Lagos days prior on a guise that she was visiting her children. This was documented in a letter Mr. Adedapo Sunday Odutola wrote to Oyinade Olurin on November 26, 1997. Oyinade Olurin, Modupe Odutola, and others have not refuted the incriminating allegations in his letter. Also, Mr. Adetokunbo Odutola confirmed that she had been away for an extended period of time before Chief Odutola died. Also, if she were there, she would have been a perfect alibi for Oyinade Olurin, and she would have also included Mama Inka as an eyewitness who could state that she also found Chief Adeola Odutola dead in his room on the morning of Thursday, April 13, 1995. Also, Oyinade Olurin forgot to include her as an alibi on Wednesday, April 12, 1995, when she claimed that he was critically ill. After all, Modupe Odutola was his last wife, and she should know. Perhaps it was an oversight on the part of Oyinade Olurin, who had about 2 months to provide a response to Mr. Ademola Odutola's letter. There are just too many lapses. Surely, Oyinade Olurin has a credibility problem. Now, Chief Odutola's wife of 40 years, Mrs. Ademola Odutola Mama Bisoye, who had 8 children, 5 sons and 3 daughters for him, was at home at the time of Oyinade Olurin's contrived story alibi. She should know if Chief Odutola was in a drowsy state. Let's for a moment reflect on Oyinade Olurin's statement. On getting to Ijebu-Ode, Oyinade Olurin, who is a medical practitioner, albeit an ophthalmologist, did not provide any hint of any medical intervention she provided to assist Chief Odutola, whom she apparently found in a very drowsy state. And what could have caused this drowsiness? Her primary concern and that of her alibi, Mama Inka, were Chief Odutola's checkbooks. So, who is Modupe Odutola Mama Inka? She is Chief Odutola's last wife with 4 illegitimate children. Chief Adeola Odutola couldn't complain loud for the fear that she could poison him. She had no empathy for Chief Odutola, and like Oyinade Olurin, she was insanely desirous to get her hands on Chief Odutola's money and properties. Now, it was actually on Monday, April 10, 1995, that Oyinade Olurin, Adebisi Bateye, Olufumilayo Olu Odutola, Olabimpe Oshinaike, Adeshola Adeyemi, Adejoke Fadino, and Folashade Shofola drove to Onibudo House, Ijebu-Ode, raided and robbed Chief Odutola. They plundered his safe and carted away with gold jewelries and coins and documents associated with his landed properties. This was documented in a letter Mr. Adedapo Sunday Odutola addressed to Oyinade Olurin on November 26, 1997. Oyinade Olurin and others have not refuted. Now that Oyinade Olurin's statements alibis have been debunked, it should be obvious that she and 9 others are guilty of a heinous crime she spearheaded, and she has been trying her best to cover up. The chickens have come home to roost.
The letter.
I told him that if Papa has asked for the keys, I would bring them immediately. But for the time being, I left some petty cash with him in case Papa needed some before I could return his keys. I never did have the keys of the safe. According to Oyinade Olurin, she drove from Ibadan to Ijebu-Ode, a 76-kilometer drive. She then had Mr. Francis, a staff member, who waits on Chief Adeola Odutola to lock up the cabinet where he keeps his checkbooks. Oyinade Olurin then took the keys of the cabinet with her to Ibadan and left some petty cash for Papa. Chief Odutola in case he needed some money before she could return the keys. And to her, that was a responsible thing to do. A statement which borders on madness is both laughable and an insult. Oyinade's statement is beyond arrogance. No one could secure his checkbooks. Mrs. Adeola Odutola Mama Bisoye, whom Chief Odutola trusted, was at home on that day. Oyinade Olurin left petty cash for the man who owns the money, who paid for education both in Nigeria and United Kingdom, bought the vehicles she drives, subsidizes her household and built clinics, Vision House, and the house her and her husband lives in Ibadan, the clinic her husband Emmanuel Olurin, a former professor with UCH, used for performing surgery in a private setting.
The letter.
When we were leaving Papa's room to go to Ibadan, Mrs. Adeyemi had joined us. She was on her way from Lagos to Ibadan and decided to pay Papa a visit before going to Ibadan. We asked Mr. Francis to put the box which contained all the important keys into the cabinet and lock it, and give me the keys. When we locked the door of the room, I asked her to keep the key because with the key of the cabinet in my custody, I did not want anyone to enter the room and tamper with the cabinet. The safe, in my opinion, was tamper-proof. Since I live in Ibadan, it is highly unlikely that I will sneak into Onibudu house at night and start rummaging in the cabinet or safe without the house staff being aware of it. When the family met and wanted to look for burial instructions, which Tokumbo said was in the safe, I did not go with the party that went downstairs. If I was depending on Papa's will to exist, I suppose I would have been tempted to go and rummage in his safe as some people would have done. I did not want to, and I did not see any part of Papa's will until it was read to all of us at Abeokuta. If you or anyone else for that matter is unhappy about the will or anything to do with Papa's death, the correct place to go is the court and demand that all the facts be laid bare instead of the incessant malicious gossips, accusations, and bitter wranglings which have been going on since Papa died. As you trail Oyinade Olurin's response, it is clear that she was very arrogant, condescending to Mr. Ademola Odutola, Chief Odutola's second son. He, of course, overlooked her business haughtiness, went on the offensive, and took her and her conspirators to court in Abeokuta, Ogun State, in suit number AB-130/96. On Wednesday, May 24, 2000, the Ogun State Supreme Court, in suit number AB-130-96, rules the will and codicil dated November 23, 1993 and March 3, 1993, respectively null and void. Oyinade Olurin and her conspirators were devastated. These were the fraudulent will and codicil Oyinade Olurin deceitfully made the probate registry read Odutola family at Abeokuta. Again, of the said will and codicil, in May 1995, Oyinade Olurin perpetrated significant fraud which makes her fully culpable of the crime of murder. Fraud that was documented in a letter Mr. Deda Kosonde Odutola addressed to Oyinade Olurin on November 26, 1997, she did not and has not refuted it. What did she do then? She colluded with Mrs. Ashiru, a senior staff member of Union Bank in Yebode, and had the bank deceptively provide the executors with a will collection document apparently signed and dated by Chief Adeola Odutola on May 19, 1995, a month after his death on April 13, 1995. Also, Oyinade Olurin in her response wrote, "I have no intention of meeting with you or anyone else anywhere outside Onibudu House. Our only connection with each other is Papa, and if you want to talk to me, see me there or in court." Now, let's for a moment listen to her talk about love and see if she's ever sincere.
For our family, I am hoping and wishing that we'll have more unity. We'll have more love. Just as I'm wishing this for our family, I'm wishing this for Ijebu land, I'm wishing this for Nigeria as a whole.
A married woman who arrogated to herself the matriarch of Odutola family when much competent and older sons were youth. An unthinkable feat in Yoruba culture. A woman who changed her last name to Odutola Olurin after the murder Chief Odutola, and who decimated the factories Chief Odutola toiled to build over many decades. In his play, Oristes, the ancient Greek dramatist, Euripides wrote, "When one with honeyed words, but evil mind persuades the law, great woes befall the state." That is Oyinade Olurin. Honeyed words, but evil mind. These events are further confirmation that she has not a drop of empathy or credibility. These and more are incontrovertible evidences that she is guilty of the gruesome crime that led to the death of 92-year-old Chief Adeola Odutola on Thursday, April 13, 1995.
The letter.
I have no intention of meeting you or anyone else anywhere outside of Nibudo House. Our only connection with each other is Papa. And if you want to talk to me, see me there or in court. I hope I have been able to put a few facts straight for your consumption and for those who, like you, you are still anxious to know how their father died or if, in fact, he did die or was killed on the way to Iran. Oyinade Olurin wrote, "For those who, like you, are still anxious to know how their father died, or in fact he did die, or was killed on the way to Ibadan, it is obvious in her concluding statement that she is detached from Adeola Odutola. She was now referring to him by their father, not our father. You say it is far-fetched to claim that she is detached. Take a look at these photos of Oyinade Olurin standing detached by the corpse of Chief Odutola at the Department of Anatomy, University of Ibadan. This is a woman who has been believing others that she is Chief Adeola Odutola's favorite and heir to his business empire."
The letter.
"With my kindest regards, yours sincerely, Oyinade Odutola Olurin." Postscript. "Since I do not know how many others besides Professor Magomuja received copies of your letter, perhaps you could be so kind as to give my reply as wide a circulation as yours. I am sending you a few copies."